Simon & Schuster Audio presents Heart of Junk by Luke Geddes. Read by Samantha Desz, Arthur Morey, George Newbern, Rebekkah Ross, and Jacques Roy.
For Steph. What is it that will last? All things are taken from us and become portions and parcels of the dreadful past. Alfred Lord Tennyson, The Lotus Eaters. Hello, I am seeking a nice roommate to share my two-bedroom home. You won't have to pay utilities or do any chores, so it's perfect for a young person or a student. But I cannot have anybody touching or moving my stuff, because it would set off a chain reaction of emotions and feelings towards you and towards my things. Hoarding is not a mental illness. It is something environmentally responsible, because I don't like to throw anything away. But the Department of Public Health said my living conditions were unsafe, and came in and forcibly removed my things I have been collecting for over 40 years. It traumatized me, and I have been rebuilding my collection ever since. Craigslist.org. Posted August 23rd, 2009, at 12:03 a.m.
Thursday. Dealer Association Meeting Day. 1. Margaret. Margaret Bird watched the two new vendors who had taken her dear friend Patricia's vacated booth, number 1-146, lug in their boxes of inventory, thinking, there were antiques, and then there were collectibles. She ought to poke her head out from behind her immaculate organized-by-color shelves of perfume bottles, some of which, on the top row, of course, locked behind thick bulletproof glass, the storage unit screwed securely to the wall, and of course, the entire set insured to its precise value, dated back to the 18th century, and introduce herself. Welcome the gentleman to the Heart of America Antique Mall family. Perhaps show them to the cafe and treat them to a package of Nilla wafers and a Pepsi from the vending machines. Yes, she certainly should, and in a little while she would. But for now, she only watched, making note of the many collectibles, which consisted of any crafted or manufactured items less than 100 years old, unlike antiques, the two men removed from overstuffed cardboard boxes and set haphazardly on the fiberglass shelving units they probably assumed the mall had provided, but which had actually belonged to Patricia. Margaret had thought her leaving them there was a sign she'd return one day. She hadn't really meant the unpleasant things she'd said 2 months ago, before she dropped, quite deliberately, Margaret's Royal Flemish biscuit jar with gold and amethyst butterfly embellishment, shattering it into 1,000 glittering pieces. But no, in retrospect, an accident, just an accident. Margaret was certain, unequivocally so, and stormed out, sending her three brutish sons to collect her inventory days later. They'd forgotten Patricia's beautiful hand-painted porcelain doll, and although it didn't fit, Margaret had been keeping it safe behind a shelf in her own booth. Margaret called her, sometimes twice a day, ready to explain away the simple misunderstanding that had led to all this trouble. She'd written her spiel down on a telephone pad just in case she got flustered or nervous. Though, why should she be nervous? The calls went unanswered, the messages unreturned. One could make out dust rings on the shelves left by Patricia's exquisite Joseph Hoffman-style candlesticks, and already these two were moving right on in, proudly displaying Dallas and the Beverly Hillbillies board games where Patricia's gilt 19th-century hand mirrors once sat, fanning back issues of Playboy and We and Mad magazine on the lowest shelves where anyone's children could get at them, and stacking tin lunchboxes whose brightly colored visages, the Fonz grinning, a tense Lee Major standing impassively in a fluorescent sea of flames, soaring dead-eyed cartoon superheroes, pot-bellied silver jumpsuited casts of science fiction television programs long forgotten, mocked everything booth number 1-146 had once been. And even though their 10 by 20 square foot space was stuffed thick and musty with the accumulated ephemera of 1,000 Generation X childhoods, they left for the parking lot and returned with still more things. Margaret's heart began to hiccup as they continued to unpack. There were artifacts, and then there were knickknacks. There were knickknacks, and then there was junk. With the emergence of each item, she was surer that these two were nothing more than half-rate junk dealers. When one of them pulled out an unopened box of Mr. T breakfast cereal, she began to choke. She needed some coffee, with a lot of cream and half a spoonful of sugar, and maybe some popcorn or those Nilla wafers. However, the only route to the cafe was past the dreaded twosome. Oh, what the heck, she thought. She may as well satisfy her own morbid curiosity. She couldn't help it. She was human too, always slowed down with the rest of them to take a gander at a grisly accident at the side of the highway, though she did it out of concern, in case someone would happen to flag her down for help. She wasn't some thrill-seeking gawker. She waited until their backs were turned to slip out of her booth and down the aisle named, according to the wood-carved street sign hanging from the ceiling, Memory Lane. But one of the men, the blonde mustachioed one, cornered her and stuck out a visibly moist palm. Hello there. She nodded, tried to smile, took his hand daintily. We're new, he said unnecessarily. The dark-haired one, his hands tangled in a bundle of video game joysticks, turned and said hello, but not so friendlily as the other. He looked at his partner in a way to suggest that the blonde always talked to strangers in terms too intimate, and that, although the dark-haired man didn't like it, he was helpless to stop him. There was something obscenely paternal in that look, especially given that the dark-haired one, judging by his receding hairline and the thin skin around his eyes, appeared significantly older than the blonde. Wasn't that the way it worked with these homosexuals? Their relationships hinged on bizarre power struggles that reversed themselves in the privacy of their bedroom, culminating in unimaginable acts of perversion. Anyway, something was off about these two. They were both so tall and thin. As a couple, they seemed unbalanced. Wasn't one of them supposed to be short and stout, the Laurel and Hardy dynamic? They were gays of a type that used to be popular on raunchy television sitcoms that Margaret, as a rule, refused to enjoy. Hawaiian shirt wearers who drank flamboyantly named martinis like fuzzy navels, sex on the beaches, and pink flamingos, who called themselves bitches and meant it as a compliment, who used words like pomo and kitsch and camp as if anyone knew what they meant. I don't think we have room for this, Lee. Blonde said to dark hair, motioning to a large styrofoam hamburger, the vestige of a defunct and better off forgotten novelty diner. He turned to Margaret and said, You mind if we keep it in your booth? Margaret must have blanched because he touched her shoulder and said, Only kidding, dear. And then, Seymour. More like an exclamation than a way of identifying himself. Margaret said uncertainly. Booth 1-138, corner of Memory Lane and Treasure Way. Seymour didn't say anything, so she added, Welcome aboard. The words tasted sour, camp counselor-ish, and unnatural. Already, these men's tackiness was affecting her. After a few weeks' exposure, she'd be decorating her mantle with plastic fast food prizes and those googly-eyed fuzzballs with sticker feet, wearing shirts that jingled with myriad gaudy charms and buttons sewn in willy-nilly patterns, eating Lucky Charms for breakfast out of a Tiffany bowl. Seymour said, Don't mind us, we're just settling in. Got this booth here and one in Hall 3 for our vinyl. She prayed that by vinyl he meant record albums, and not some sort of depraved sex apparel. You just never knew when it came to these people. They had been here less than a day, and already they'd staked their claim to multiple halls. As much as it would anguish her, Margaret would have to investigate their other booth later. As the heart of America's senior-most dealer, it was her duty. Nice to meet you, Lee said without sincerity and then left, probably to gather even more junk. Frankly, she preferred his rudeness to Seymour's, hello there, aren't I cute, brand of social charm. He was presently digging through the boxes and humming. Having made himself known, he evidently had no interest in continuing the conversation, no desire to ask Margaret what sorts of antiques, official dictionary definition, interested her, how long she'd been in the industry, or if she would introduce him to the community of dealers who made the heart of America their home away from home. Just as she was preparing to sigh pointedly and leave for the cafe, he yanked out of a box an object so vile and blatantly violative to the mall's clear policy guidelines that Margaret swore she could taste, she could actually taste, a wisp of vomit in the back of her throat. It was a doll, not just any doll, but one fashioned in the likeness of a man named M.C. Hammer, whom Margaret, though she'd never cared for popular music, preferring opera and classical, recalled as a rap musician she'd watched, despite herself, perform his clangorous so-called songs on many late-night talk shows in the 90s. The man, with his ridiculous circus pants and a swagger that intimated violence, had been inescapable. Margaret especially did not care for rap music, or whatever nonsense name it was called by now. The doll was of compatible dimensions with the Barbies and Kens that Dolores Kovach sold in Hall 2, and manufactured by the same company. With horror, she pictured it, in its distasteful sparkling outfit, cavorting with the clean-cut figures of her childhood. Staring out of those still, white eyes and flashing that menacing grin as he reclined on the dreamhouse sofa, his arm around Barbie, stripped down to her black and white underthing, a nearby boombox quaking with a cacophony.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.